Welcome to the 2017 Youth Advocacy Day, and thank you to the advocates, youth, and decision makers that could be here today. We all know why we're here. Today is a day to celebrate all the progress that has been made in making Kentucky a better place for children. That being said, I should probably introduce myself. My name is Tessa, I'm 17 and I live at Homeward Bound Shelter in East Kentucky. And I'm a member of the First Ladies Youth Leadership Program, and that's why I am here to talk to you guys today. Youth advocacy is really important to me because I never had a choice. When I was taken from my home at 13, my mom is an alcoholic, and like a lot of kids, I fought against it because I didn't know any better. What my mom was doing wasn't a problem to me. But in some senses, I knew that what was happening wasn't normal. It's not normal for a person to drink an entire 12-pack in one night. It's not normal to tuck your own mother into bed. But still, I labeled myself as normal. I had a life, I had friends, and I was happy. Given the choice back then, I would have asked to stay. But given the choice now, I would ask for family counseling because not enough was done to preserve my family. And I do believe that my life could have been very, very vastly different if only something had been done. After being removed from my mother's home, I went with various family members, but none of them provided the safety, support, and stability that we needed. After three tumultuous years in which we were subjected to physical and emotional abuse, in which we adjusted to and then were ripped from four different schools, we ended up living in a shelter, which has been my home for over a year now, and where I'm staying until I finish my senior year at high school. At this moment, there are nearly 8,000 children in foster care in Kentucky, and a much greater number, over 71,000 of us, were involved in investigations by the child welfare system to determine whether or not our homes are safe for us. But in too many cases, things don't get better, they get worse. In too many cases, we slip through the cracks. I have experienced this firsthand, and I hear it from too many kids at the shelter where I live. Since coming to the shelter, I've heard stories that make my skin crawl. I've held someone as they cried because they had to go back to a situation like mine. I've comforted kids who have found out that their sibling was being abused at their foster home and that there was nothing that they could do about it and that the state wouldn't move them. I've heard of physically and sexually abused kids who've tried to kill themselves, kids who turned to drugs, kids who were ripped away from their families and sent hours away in order to find a foster home to accommodate them. You name it, I've seen it. There are some truly awful things that happen to kids in Kentucky every day, and nobody knows, but no more. That's why the things we do here today are so important. Things have to change. That is the reason why, despite how nervous I am to tell my story, I am standing here in front of you today. Because I never want to have to hear one of those stories again. I never had an input in the decisions that affected me, and my story is a copy of many. Kids like me get tossed around and feel ignored because overloaded, underpaid caseworkers are scrambling for a place to put us, scrambling for a family to care for us. But we're just kids, and the adults know best, right? Wrong. We are people, and we have a voice. I am the future, and so are you, and you, and you, and everyone in this room. And to all the adults in the audience today, and to the lawmakers here today, we are your children. We are the children of Kentucky. It doesn't matter who you are or what your past is. Anyone can make a difference and stand up for Kentucky's invisible children. We are here today to ignite change. That is the purpose of today.
Thank you, Terry.
To lend our support.
It is an honor to be here with you today and everyone else here for Kentucky Youth Advocates Child Advocacy Day. My name is Michael Rabkin. I am the Communications Director for Passport Health Plan, where it is our mission to improve the health and quality of life for our members. Passport is a nonprofit, Kentucky-based health plan that has been committed to ensuring that vulnerable children all over Kentucky have access to health care for almost 20 years. We are committed to help build healthier communities and support efforts to improve the health of the children all around the Commonwealth. That is why it is so important for us to be here today with all of you, working towards a better future for Kentucky's children. We appreciate our advocates and our elected officials for all they do to help make this happen. Thank you all for being here and for showing your support. As we continue to look ahead to a brighter future for our children, I'm going to turn it over now to some young people who are going to motivate everyone here to keep supporting our kids.
All right, well, everybody join us as we do this chant. This side over here is going to say kids, and Ellie's side over here is going to say count. So, kids!
Count!
And I'm with the PALS Leadership Group, the Promising Appalachian Leaders in Service. I'm with the Promising Appalachian Leaders in Service Group. I am a senior at Owsley County High School, and here with me is Chelsea Featherly, a third grader at Kirksville Elementary. We would like to welcome to the podium a leader who puts kids first, who takes action on our behalf, and who knows that policies here in Frankfort affect kids like us. He is your Senate President, but back home, he is our supporter. On behalf of the kids of the Commonwealth, thank you for all that you do for us and always being in our corner. Please join us in welcoming Senate President Leader Robert Stivers.
Well, I always appreciate the opportunity to come to speak at this rally. I have to admit right off the bat, it's the first time in my 21 years I've been compared to a beetle. But let me tell you this, let me be a little bit serious after that. You know, I came here 21 years ago and actually I had three small children. I've had one child since I've been here. They're all graduating high school or in college or actually in the workforce. I say this quite often, that the decisions that were made to affect my life were made years ago. If you want to think about a road that we travel in our life, that life road, my road's been paved. The decisions have been made. There's not much I can do to change the circumstances for which I live in. But what I can do is be available to this group to help pave their road in life, to get rid of some of the bumps, the potholes, the detours, to make it simpler and make it better. You know, Terry talked about two or three things, and truly, we do want to look at education. Education is a great equalizer, and we are trying to do that. We want to make sure that we have a system that gives every student, not just some, the best opportunities they can have, be it in Owsley County, or be it in Jefferson County, or if they have to move out of state, we want them to be competitive. And that's the type of education system we want. We want to make sure when there are children that have problems and get involved in the justice system, that we afford them every opportunity to right their ship and get back on that road, a good road, as it is going to be paved for their life. But let me tell you one other thing that I think is very critical, and the governor has spoke passionately about this. Looking at our system, and Speaker Hoover, I call him Jeff, and I think maybe the most critical thing we can do in this session and in the next few sessions is looking at those children who may be in kinship care or who may be in a foster home, who may not even be in a home at all, and see how we can streamline, how we can expedite, and how we can be more efficient to find those parents who want to adopt a child and that child that wants to be in a home and marry them together in a home environment, in a family environment. We've got a system that has gotten too bureaucratic. And with the bureaucracy, we exclude some people from being able to adopt these children and bring them into their home because it becomes too expensive. There are many quality potential parents out there of all economic strata, but we have effectively excluded many because we have a system that is just too costly. This is the direction we need to go when we think about the children here, the children throughout the state, to make sure we do pave that road, that we do have something bright for them to look at in the future. And hopefully, in time, and we do have constraints, make no doubt about it, there are constraints. We don't have unlimited funds. We do the best we can with the funds we have. But in time, with the governor's leadership, both chambers' leadership, the judiciary, Republicans and Democrats alike, because nobody asks any of these children when they go to school or when they go to bed, when they go to a doctor, when they're hungry or potentially homeless, what is your politics? We need to come together as a group and make sure, in time, under the constraints we have, that these areas are addressed, they're fixed, and we create the best road, build the best road we can for these students, for these children, so their travels through life will be smooth. So to each and every one of you, to the young lady who spoke, to the individuals in the crowd and the audience, I say keep your voices strong and make sure they stay loud. I appreciate the opportunity to come over, speak to you, and let you know what our perspective is. And I always appreciate that opportunity and appreciate the work that Terry Brooks does. Thank you all so much.
Thank you, President Stivers. In just a second, President Stivers and a couple other legislators are going to receive an award, and they're really nice awards, but I also know his office has lots of plaques and posters. So I wanted to give him something to make him think a little bit every day when he walked in. And so I got a really fancy award that has a picture of Snoopy jumping into the arms of Charlie Brown. And on that plaque, or on that little thing, it says, "It's a new day. Dive right in." Mr. President, we think it's a new day, and it's a great time to dive in for kids in Kentucky. Thank you. Thank you, Mr. President. Before we recognize some legislative champions who are here, I wanted to recognize some partner organizations that were here. And you already heard from one, which is Passport. They are the signature sponsor for our Kids Count work, and we deeply appreciate that. We also need to highlight three or four other groups with whom Children's Advocacy Day and the Blueprint for Kentucky's Children would not be possible. So what I'd ask you to do is hold your applause till I introduce all of them, and then let's give them a big thank you. One is Dr. Cliff Maisaka, who's CEO of Delta Dental of Kentucky. You want to stand up? Barry Salovitz, representing Casey Family Programs from Seattle, is here. Frank Harshaw, who, as you may know, is a business leader who has started a nonprofit called True Up, which is a real movement around foster kids. And finally, the guru president and CEO of Cozair Charities, which is absolutely the group in this state leading the fight around abuse and neglect is Randy Coe. So, Michael, you need to stand up too, and let's give all five a big thanks. Each year we try to recognize some champions for kids in general and then specifically. So I do want to recognize three folks and then get into two others specifically. First of all, we want to welcome our new juvenile justice commissioner to Kentucky. Commissioner Cockrell is here. Would you stand up? And what I can tell you... is the excellent work that Representative Owen, Senator Westerfield, and Secretary Tilley began. The new commissioner exemplifies those values. And I was really serious that we do believe this session you are going to see a major game-changing effort in an omnibus bill around juvenile justice. And Mr. Commissioner, you are absolutely a catalyst in making that happen, and we appreciate it. We also want to recognize two other legislators for the moment, and I'm not sure where you are, so you're going to need to wave your hand so we can thank you. Representative Walker and Senator, is Senator Thomas here? Representative Thomas. He left. So, Representative Walker, we appreciate you being here today. Thank you so much. We also wanted to recognize two other legislators, and we typically, as you may know, give awards this Children's Advocacy Day for the efforts of last year. So we don't just give awards, but I want to talk to you about two things about these folks, and so maybe Representative Jenkins and Representative Wooshner can head up this way. I'll wait till they get up here.
Huh? Should I be to your left?
You do. I asked Joni to get to my left, but she said she's on your left, so there we go. I'd like to talk about two or three things that happened last year and extrapolate a couple lessons, and both of these folks really do represent that. The first is that last year there were so many bills around abuse and neglect that went back and forth and forth and back. And I don't know if you noticed, but occasionally in Frankfort, partisanship and toxicity may get in the way. Last year, Senator Rocky Adams and Representative Jenkins did absolutely stellar work in being consummate diplomats, going from chamber to chamber. In one case, frankly, Representative Jenkins purposefully stepped back and took a back roll so something could happen. And I think that kind of leadership and that kind of diplomacy is all too rare and needs to be recognized. I think Representative Wooshner's contribution last year, and as you all know, Joni and Adia, like, they have... We tend to give Joni red tennis shoe awards because she's such a big University of Louisville fan. And her office is filled with tennis shoes because both of these ladies have been leaders for children for so long. Last session, Representative Wooshner, along with Senator Carroll, taught everybody a really big lesson, which is sometimes spending money on the front end actually adds to the state budget on the back end. She was absolutely critical in increasing eligibility for child care supports. And what we all know is that allowing more parents to have more support for child care does what? Well, it helps kids and it helps families, but it actually puts more folks in the workforce, generates more revenue, and it's one of those rare opportunities where it's a win for kids, a win for families, a win for local economies, and a win for the state budget. So if we can have our young people come up, would you join them and me in thanking Representatives Wooshner and Jenkins for always, always being there for kids? Just a reminder, we want you to pack out Representative Wooshner's health and welfare meeting. Again, she is leading the cause around a major piece of kinship reform, and we appreciate that. We assume you're going to be back up here next year getting an award for that particular bill, okay? Yeah. The person I mentioned who absolutely rocked the rotunda last Children's Advocacy Day is Katie Akumo. And the only negative feedback we got, and I never get anything negative about Katie, but every legislator came up to me afterward and said, please tell me she is not going to move to my district and run against me. Because there is nobody who could beat Katie, I don't believe. Katie is going to come up and share some closing thoughts with you. So, Katie, you want to walk up this way, and I want to do one other thing. Katie is very, very modest. But if you remember Katie's story, she has not had the easiest life. But through just flat-out grit and lots of help from lots of folks, she is just what makes Kentucky's kids so good. And can I tell you a little story? Next fall, Katie begins a full-ride scholarship at Harvard.
Thank you so much. Thank you. I was not expecting that. Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
As was just said, my name is Katie Okumu. I'm a senior at Berea Community High School. And today, we are celebrating a first birthday, which is most fitting for a rally for children. 1 year ago, at Children's Advocacy Day, an idea which then grew into a force for change was born. 1 year ago, I shared my story about growing up in the care of my great-grandmother and the challenges that I have faced. 1 year ago, First Lady Glenna Bevin heard my story and stories like mine. As a result, she created the First Ladies Youth Leadership Council. With her guidance and her encouragement, a small but committed group of young people from across the state have been working to change policies and practices related to child welfare to help more children across the Commonwealth have a safer and more loving home. So, if you have been wondering, does Children's Advocacy Day really matter? Know that it does. 1 year ago, my voice, a voice of a child, was heard. An action was taken on behalf of children like me in kinship care. Today, we honor leaders who've listened to the voices of Kentucky children. But we also, most of all, we honor the young people themselves who have been standing up for Kentucky children, have been amplifying all voices. So, if you would, please join me in thanking my fellow members of the First Ladies Youth Leadership Council, and in thanking Randy Coe from Cosair Charities and Barry Salovitz, I apologize for that, Salovitz, from Casey Family Programs, because their support has been invaluable to our council. Thank you. And now we are going to hear from the voices of some of our youngest Kentuckians in the room. You guys would like to come around.
Thank you. So luckily, we are almost done. My name is Jesse Wittish. I'm the Chief External Affairs Officer with Kentucky Youth Advocates. So as I said, we're about to wrap up, but just a couple of things before we do. If you have not yet picked up your folder with a packet of materials, you can head up to the mezzanine right after this and grab one of those folders there. Second, a couple of notes about what is next today. I'm sure that you all have meetings scheduled with your legislators, but if you can fit in just a couple more things, we would love for you to be able to do that. First, the House Health and Family Services Committee meeting is meeting at a special time today. So thank you, Representative Wooshner, for accommodating all of these advocates here. You should go to that at 11 o'clock. That is in Annex Room 169. They are going to hear a blueprint legislative priority, House Bill 180, sponsored by Representative Wooshner, which would allow close family friends to be recognized as kinship caregivers. Another thing you may want to check out is the Blueprint Policy Information Session that's happening at 12:30 in Annex Room 149, where you can learn more about blueprint policies, which is especially important if you want to be an advocate after Children's Advocacy Day, so everything to do after this. So today I am humbled, I am sure these leaders are humbled by all of the commitment that you all are showing to Kentucky kids today. I know some of you traveled in very cold weather and made a long trip to be here because you know that the future of Kentucky tomorrow depends on what we do for kids today. So with that, I am gonna turn it back over to Emily and Ellie, who are gonna send us off. Thank you.
We're going to sing a song, so everybody sing with us.
Ready? One, two, three.
CAD, talking about advocacy. It's easy as one, two, three. Advocacy, one, two, three. Do it for you and me. CAD, talking about advocacy. It's easy as one, two, three. Advocacy. One, two, three, do it for you and me, legislators.
Do you want to say, like, as you're leaving, chant with us or something?
As you are leaving, we would like for you to chant with us. So we are going to chant, vote for kids.
Ready?
Ready?
One, two, three.
Vote for kids! 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 Vote for kids!
Okay.